Morning. Welcome to the 16th committee of the Welfare Reform Committee for 2015. Could everyone ensure that their mobile phones and other electronic devices are switched to airplane mode silent? Thank you. First item on our agenda is the future delivery of social security in Scotland, disability carers and those who are ill. In today's session, we'll continue to focus on issues surrounding disabilities, carers and those who are ill or who have long-term conditions. Again, we're using roundtable format and hope that that will encourage some interaction. And you know, for the witnesses who are here today, welcome. But if you do want to ask questions or make comments, just try to catch my attention or Simon's attention. We'll engage you as much as we can, but you know, try to speak one at a time to allow the official report to get a record. We've had apologies from Aidan McCorry, who's the Chief Executive of Deaf Action, who unfortunately is unwell. But today I'd like to welcome to the Scottish Parliament Sonya Chowdhury, Chief Executive Action for ME, Bill Scott, the Director of Policy for Inclusion Scotland, Rachel Stewart, who's the Public Affairs Officer for the Scottish Association for Mental Health, Andrew Strong, who's the Policy and Information Manager, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, and Professor Nick Watson from the Institute for Health and Wellbeing at the University of Glasgow. I don't know if any of our witnesses want to say anything in terms of an opening contribution, or if not, I'll just move to questions. But could I maybe just throw open to the invited guests today, what principles do you think should underpin any new social security system in Scotland?
Can I?
Sure.
I mean, I think one of the key things that we have to look at is in terms of there's lots of different levels of looking at for disability benefit. We need to be looking at issues around providing support and issues around work. And sometimes these two are different in terms of what we're looking for. And so we have you know, issues around, for example, the disability living allowance, which is different from employment support allowance and getting people into work. So I think we need to look at that. But for me, though, one of the key issues that we've got at the moment is the at the moment, in the response, since about mid-2000, we've had a succession of policies that have been aimed at getting people off benefits and making it harder to get onto benefits. So we switched to personal capacity assessment, and then from personal capacity assessment, we went to ESA, Employment Support Allowance, which brought in work capacity assessment. And all of these increased or made it harder to get on to benefits, and also made it easier for people to be pushed off benefits into, for example, the Work-Related Advisory Group, or RAG, and so on. And I think that the problem has been, the key problem that's been with developing all of these is it's been about that it's located the issue within, so work capacity assessment, which is based on a model of disability called the biopsychosocial model of disability. And I'm sorry to get all technical, but it's a model, and it is a model that Lord Freud claims has theoretical credibility, but nobody else would, or very few other people, would support that claim. And what the model is based on is the assumption that if people with back pain are forced back to work early or are told to move a lot, the back gets better. And so they've applied that same thinking to mental health problems and to cardiorespiratory problems, which with back pain make up two-thirds of the reason why people are off work. And so we've got the emergence of things like RAG, which has had evidence to date has suggested that very few people who are being placed in the work-related advisory group are moving into work. So that isn't working, yet the response has been to make RAG temporary so that people have to reapply every year, even though it isn't working. And I think that the other key problem has been that we've located all the problem for getting disabled people into work with disabled people. So what we've done is we think the solution to finding employment for disabled people is to put more disabled people in the unemployed category, and somehow or other they'll emerge into work. It's very, very much this downstream. We increase the number of disabled people applying for work, they will get jobs, rather than actually starting to tackle some of the discrimination that disabled people find in finding work. And in terms of work capacity assessment, for example, it says, are you fit for work? Rather than, actually, a better thing would be, are you likely to find work? So, for example, I can find work very easily, but if I had the same impairment that I have, but didn't have the academic qualifications that I did, I'd be unlikely to find, I couldn't do manual work, so I would be unlikely to find work. And I think one of the problems is that we're locating it we're seeing individuals rather than saying, in the old personal capacity assessment, there used to be a category of are they likely to find work, and that category is completely gone now. So as well as looking at the individual, we've got to look at are they likely to find work. And in the model that we might want to look at in terms of work is the Australian model, where there's been much more work with employers about trying to break down the reluctance of employers to employ disabled people. And at the moment, we're not working on that at all. We're just assuming that we make more and more people into the labour market, and somehow or other they'll magically get into jobs. And the evidence isn't there to support that claim.
Okay.
Sonya?
I think it's a great question to ask. You know, what are the principles that our system should be based on? Because at the end of the day, what you're saying is, how do you want to be treated as a human being? And there are a couple of comments reading through a study that we've just undertaken with people in Scotland about the personal independence payment system. People talk about the system, the process of applying, dehumanising them. And there's a great quote, I don't want your sympathy, just your respect. So your question when you ask us about principles, it needs to be fair, it needs to be equitable. I don't think there are many people that would say, actually, anybody who thinks they're entitled to benefits should get them. There has to be a system to share out the limited resources, but it's got to be respectful. And I think some of the things that Nick was talking about, one sort of question, if you think about empathy and understanding, if you go along and somebody says to you, what is it important for me to know about how your illness affects you so that I can make sure this process is as accessible as I can make it, immediately relaxes you and it enables you to engage in a dialogue. At the moment, we've got people, we're told, that assessors are reading from screens, that they're just reading from a list of questions. How is that respectful? If I sat here and talked to you from my screen for the next hour and 45 minutes, you'd switch off, you wouldn't want to engage with me. So I think when we think about principles, we should think about what is it that makes us human and makes us caring and sensitive towards others.
Bill?
Yeah, I very much agree with the idea that the system has to be based on really treating every person that comes into it as a human being like any other, and with dignity and respect. And I think that's missing from the current system, which is all about saving benefit spend. And if we embedded that into the system, I think we also need to think about what the purpose of the system is. And the purpose of the benefit system should be to support disabled people and carers and people with long-term sickness to participate in society. Because at the moment, they're socially isolated. It's not just that they're excluded from the labour market. They're excluded from normal family life. They're excluded from community life. They're excluded from political life. And all of those things lead to them being marginalised. And if the system existed to support people to participate in all those things, and that's what purpose was, then I think we would begin to see a change in societal attitudes towards disabled people and towards carers that would actually lead to greater participation, because people would begin to understand some of the barriers that they face in everyday life.
Okay. Andrew?
Yeah, I would echo the points that have been made already and very eloquently as well. In the Alliance's view, we would back a human rights-based approach, something which, you know, Bill referred to some of the rights people have, people being socially isolated. And actually, if you look at people's human rights and base the system around about that, then we'd be in a much stronger place than we are at the moment. I think some of the elements of what a system would need to look like would be to include things like accessible information at as early stage as possible. I think a lot of people experiencing a lot of difficulty around about understanding when they've been asked to come to an assessment, what that assessment is about, understanding the questions that they're asked during the assessment. And I think things like easy read provided before and after the assessment would be really helpful to people. I think also we need to look at an approach which is based on accuracy of assessment rather than targeted means to get people off of benefits. So avoiding lengthy appeals rather than, you know, avoiding giving people benefits. I think that's an issue, because you end up with kind of costly ongoing situations in terms of appeals which are leading to people becoming more stressed as the process goes on. I think we also need to look at greater flexibility in terms of assessment processes as well, timings, things like that, where the assessment is. We need to do a lot more of supporting people to be assessed at home where that's possible. And I also think that we need to look at appropriately funded sources of support to help people through the assessment, particularly independent advocacy. The Alliance and the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance have a one-year pilot at the moment, which is working in four areas of Scotland. And that's supporting people with advocacy support during the assessment process, which is alleviating some of the stress that people are experiencing going to the assessment, but it's also mitigating against some of the bad practice that we've heard about during this process, some of the things that Sonia's talking about assessors looking at a screen and typing away and not showing the compassion. And I think compassion is the thing that we would really want to see out of any new system.
Okay. Rachel, did you want to say something?
Well, it's hard to add to so many eloquent... that's a challenge, sorry. Apologies. I think we need to look at the overall context about how some of the challenges and changes are going to be delivered in Scotland in the wider context of how the reserve benefits are also being delivered at present and how those two systems are going to join up and meet together, as well as the integration of health and social care and self-directed support at local level too. There isn't the same stigma about going to the NHS to get help when you're not well, but there is a stigma about accessing benefits when you're not well. And I don't know, when these two systems were set up at around the same time and linked in very much together, why those two directions have diverged. People need the benefit system to live their lives to the best of their capacity, and it's something that we in Scotland need to take a more humane approach to than the punitive approach that has been taken to date.
Could I pick up on that last point and link it to a comment that Sonia made? Sonia said that the system, we need a system to share out limited resources. Do you think that when we establish our own model of the benefits that will be devolved to us, that it should be on the basis of the current expenditure? Should it be on the basis of increased expenditure? Should it be on the basis of just living with whatever you have, which, you know, potentially in the next few years is going to be less than what we have just now? Should there be any losers, or should everyone have at the very least the benefits that they are currently receiving before the various changes kick in? Sonia?
For me to say, of course there should be more money. People who are disabled with long-term chronic conditions should get the support that they need and they deserve. But actually the losers are the taxpayers. because I'm paying for, I'm contributing to a system that puts people through a costly process that dehumanises them, and after 12 months makes them do that again, despite having a long-term chronic illness like ME, where people are very, very severely disabled, a hidden illness where there's lots of stigma, that actually for some individuals, particularly 25% who are bedbound for years, often decades, are going through a system after 12 months where really, actually, they've got no potential to improve in terms of their illness within that time frame. So why are they being reassessed after 12 months? I'd be really interested to see how much that process costs from a social return on investment perspective. How am I going to get better value for money as a taxpayer? So I think that yes, we're unlikely to see increased investment. I think many of us would accept that. But what I want to see is a more efficient and a more effective service.
Okay. Sorry, Rachel and then Bill.
That's an excellent point that Sonia's just made. We know that by the time the personal independence payment and DLA are devolved to Scotland, it will be 2017. The rollout of PIP is due to take place on a wider scale in Scotland from next month. And the Scottish Government themselves reckon that about 100,000 people in Scotland who had previously been eligible for DLA will lose that eligibility with the rollout of PIP. From that point of view, it's very hard to see how the health and social care costs of those individuals, if they can still qualify, especially for social care costs, how those costs are not going to increase. So I think taxpayers in the round are still going to be paying a lot of money, but the human impact on those individuals' lives, the human impact on whether or not those individuals, if they are employed, because it's not a work replacement, it's not an income replacement benefit, can still stay in work. Or if people who would have been filtered onto the Work Choice programme, which is also being devolved, because of their disability, will end up into a more generalised work programme style programme, which would be less effective for them because of their condition.
Okay, just before I bring Bill in, Claire, Bill.
It was just a supplementary on the issue of reassessment. Obviously, for everyone going through that, that's a stressful process, but we've taken evidence that actually for people with mental health issues, it can actually make their condition worse. I just wondered if you had some evidence on that basis.
We've been speaking to our service users in focus groups, and the three things that they raise again and again are the impact of the employment and support allowance, work capacity assessment, the fear of sanctions or the impact of sanctions, and the looming rollout of PIP, because they feel, you know, 88,000 people in Scotland on the lower care rate of DLA are simply not going to qualify for that, and about 22% of our service users would receive the lower care rate of DLA, so that they probably won't qualify as a result. We have seen more intensive support required from our support workers to our service users in the run-up to an assessment, because their mental health is suffering, and we're also struggling to be able, we're supposed to be helping them to recover, and we're having to try to work harder to maintain some of them to meet this, because the assessment's coming. Some of them, because they're having assessments for the work capability assessment, and then they know that PIP is coming too, there is this issue about, I've just had an assessment and now I've got another assessment, and it's the same kind of questions, and there's a lack of understanding and a lack of clarity. There's a real lack of understanding about their rights. We're on the steering group on the advocacy project that Andrew mentioned from the Alliance and SIA's project, and that's something that is garnering really good results in terms of helping people to advocate for themselves and providing them with that reassurance and making sure that they're prepared. So that would be something that could help them with a reassessment. But it's almost making people more unwell in the run-up to it. And, you know, I mean, we're a recovery-focused organisation, and it's distressing for our workers to see. So.
Bill, and then Nick.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the number of assessments that the current benefit system has are far too many for disabled people. It's the work capability assessment, there's PIP assessments, there's care assessments, etc. Blue badge assessments now as well. So reducing the number of assessments would save the government money. The new personal independence payment assessment, according to the National Audit Office, about 18 months ago, costs about £182 per assessment to administer, compared to £49 for the Disability Living Allowance assessment. Now, if you're going to spend four times as much on administering the system, then you're spending money on that rather than on the benefits. And that works out, I think, about £22 million in Scotland is being spent on that, is going to be spent on that by the time you inherit disability living allowance and personal independence payment. So you could make savings by reducing the number of assessments. DLA was largely paper assessed, and it had a very, very low fraud rate, exceptionally low, below 2%, which compares very favourably with a lot of the rest of the benefit system. So it's very low levels of fraud, which are going to still exist even with the assessment system that we're inheriting. So you could save money there, but I'm not going to pretend that you can simply, I don't know where you're going to leave around £300 odd million, to the new disability benefits budget, because that's how much you're going to have lost. And although it's only 20% off the current budget, it's actually closer to now to almost 40% off the budget for working age disabled people. And that is where all the cuts are falling. Pensioners are exempt from these new assessments, and children are exempt from the new assessments. So they'll be safe. But in saving them from the cuts fall disproportionately on working age disabled people. And again, to give you another example, 49,000 people on higher rate disability living allowance are going to lose it. One in three of those uses their payment to lease a motability vehicle. And they use that motability vehicle to get to work. So 16,000 disabled people face losing their jobs because they will not have a means of getting to their workplace, because they'll no longer have their motability vehicle unless they use their wages to make up the difference in maintaining the lease on the car. So it's not only that the changes are failing to move disabled people into work, and there's less disabled people in work than there were before the start of the recession, many proportionately less. It's actually that it's driving people out of work, and the stress that affects people doesn't just affect people with mental health issues. People with physical impairments, variable impairments like ME, like MS, etc., those conditions are affected by stress, and they make those conditions worse. And there is evidence that those conditions are being worsened by the current work capability assessment regime. There's good research evidence that that is taking place, and that people's physical condition is being affected by their mental health condition.
Sorry, just before I bring Nick and then Kevin and Neil in, Bill, you mentioned there £300 million would be lost, and you weren't sure how we could replace it. But of course, in a sense, that's down to opportunity cost. It's down to political decisions. For us to make, both as a parliament and as a government and as a society, £300 million could be found by increasing taxes, income tax. It could be found by not paying councils the money that paid for the council tax freeze, allowing them to use that and using that money for disability. It could be used to keep air passenger duty. It could be used, small business bonus, there could be a lot of things. It's really down to choices that we make in society and what our relative priorities are. Indeed, it could be used so that universal benefits to people like me aren't there and instead targeted on people with illnesses and disabilities.
But I would want that. Our organisation would want that. We'd want that money to be found from whatever means necessary to do it. But I also know that the Scottish Parliament is going to be facing another round of spending cuts with the spending review, which is aimed at reducing overall government expenditure by between 25 and 40%. So disabled people and carers are going to be competing with many other groups in society who are going to be losing services, and you are going to be faced with extremely difficult choices. And
so
it's not just the 300 million. You know, the 300 million will happen if with the transfer from DLA to PIP, but you're going to have many, many other benefits being cut and many, many services facing cuts, including education and health. And you know, that is the context in which you're going to have to think about where the money is going to come from. And I agree, you know, the money could come from a number of places. You know, a fairer system of local government taxation would raise revenue that you could use to increase social participation at a local level, and you know, provide the sort of services that are being withdrawn at the moment, like taxi cabs. You know, really, again, essential to assist disabled people in participating in society. But those cuts are happening alongside the benefit cuts. That's I think that's what you have to understand. It's not just that take the 300 million, let's find that. It's where do we also find, I don't know, what eventually the cuts will be to spending in Scotland, but they're going to be substantial.
Okay, Nick and then Kevin and Neil.
I think Bill raised and everybody else raised some really interesting points, and really important points. First of all, that we've been doing work with disabled students, and their inclusion is contingent on those benefits. If you remove the they all describe themselves as very included, and because it would be at the university.
Can you explain in what way the participation is
contingent? Well, without it, if we take away their mobility allowance, they can't get in and out of the university. If you take away their support, they can't do what they need to do as students and their personal support. So I think it's key there for including disabled people. But I think one other thing that we have to recognise as well is the knock-on effect that pulling large amounts of money from disabled people will have on the communities they live in. And one of the things that we have to remember is that, you know, impairment and disability is very linked to poverty. And in our poorest environments, there are the highest levels of disability. And if we start taking, you know, £200 million out of the very... If we take large amounts of money out of the very poor communities, those communities will become even poorer. And as people will be employing local people as carers or as PAs or as in other areas, we start removing that money. So clearly it will affect the disabled people, but it will also greatly affect those communities around where disabled people live. And pulling out however many million from Scotland's poorest areas will... We did a little piece of work looking at it a few years ago, just looking at some raw figures, and we were estimating that between £1 and £2 million a year would be taken out of Parkhead and about £200,000 a year taken out of Hillhead. Hillhead can afford to lose that amount of money, but you take that amount of money out of Parkhead, then shops will close. It's just that the long-term effects that removing benefits from disabled people will have, not just on them, but on the communities that they live in, that needs to be looked at.
Okay, Kevin and Neil.
Thank you, convener. We've taken a fair amount of evidence in the committee at your say sessions about how benefits ensure that folks can go to work. And the Tory have said that the reasons for these changes to social security are to get folk into work, but we see these adverse effects on disabled people who are working at this moment in time. We had somebody who is a net contributor, if you like, who gets at the moment high level DLA and pays more in tax and national insurance than they get in that DLA, but would be unable to work if they didn't get that DLA. Bill mentioned that there were some 16,000 folks who were reliant on motability to get to work. I wonder if folk have, around the table have done any analysis on what effect that is in terms of tax and national insurance that is no longer coming in, and what that is actually going to cost if all of these so-called reforms go ahead. And beyond that, you know, that's the monetary cost, but the human cost of folk no longer working and all of the rest is going to be even greater. So I'd be grateful to the panel if we can maybe expand that out and how we can create a system which has some common sense and logic to it to allow folk that independence to go out and work.
Okay, Neil and then John.
In relation to claims and how someone goes through a claim, how many, what percentage of people who go through the process successfully, say for DLA, do that on their own without any advocacy or help? Does anybody know?
Sonia?
Speak in terms of the research that we've done with people with ME, the majority of people with ME do not get any support whatsoever. The majority of people with ME that have responded to our consultations are not accessing mainstream services. They're very busy, there's high demand, and for people with ME who are so severely ill, they're not able to get to the services, they're cognitively challenged, they also experience something called post-exertional malaise. So actually coming along to talk today for somebody with ME could cost them 3 weeks, 3 days, 3 months, maybe even longer because of the payback that they experience physically. So actually asking for support can be very difficult because of the physical challenges. We run a specialist welfare advice service and some of our callers aren't able to talk on the phone for more than a few minutes. So there is a very, very strong cost for people in terms of accessing support, even if that existed. So there does need to be a creative solution applied to providing advocacy support for individuals.
Where I'm going with this, I don't know, maybe I didn't explain it too well, is that what appears to be happening is that we're institutionalising advocacy and support, because the only way you can get through the system successfully is through having advocacy and support. Now, surely that is not right, that the average person in the street should be able to fill in a form and successfully provide the information necessary in order to get a successful claim. Is it the case, therefore, that people have to get advocacy? And certainly in my experience of dealing with the benefits system as a housing official, you know, it got to the stage where we filled in every single form for every single tenant, otherwise it was a problem. Now, that shouldn't be the case. The system shouldn't be so complex that an ordinary person in the street can't fill it in successfully.
I'll try and answer that, Neil. There are particular issues in terms of the complexity of the forums now. And you know, everybody would say that. And I'm an ex-welfare rights worker as well. And you know, anybody who gets support in filling in a form stands a better chance of getting the benefit. But on top of that, anybody that's accompanied to an assessment stands a better chance of getting the benefit as well, even if the person accompanying them isn't a welfare rights worker. Something about the fact that there's a witness there who can, you know, corroborate what was said, all of those sort of things can influence the eventual outcome of the claim. But one of the things you have to bear in mind is we still live in a society where the functional illiteracy rate is around 1 in 5 of the population, but they're not evenly spread throughout the population. They're concentrated amongst those who are most likely to claim benefits. So that is why there's a greater need for advocacy for that group. And, you know, we worked with West Lothian Council, and local advice agencies, carers organisations, etc., to actually set up training for volunteers to accompany people to go to assessments. And you know, I think that's been quite successful. And we would like to see that sort of thing building social assets, because there are many people in the communities who do want to help and do, you know, where a certain amount, a minimum amount of training could actually act as an advocate for somebody. And we also encourage peer advocacy So disabled people themselves can often be the best supporters of another disabled person because they understand the condition that that person has because it's the same one that they have. So, you know, those sort of things. But you're right, you know, we are seeing almost a professionalisation of this happening because the system has become more complex. Again, before I was a welfare rights worker, I worked for the Department of Employment when it was called that, but before it became the DWP. And we used to issue letters explaining what the outcome of the claimant's claim was that were a page to 2 pages long. We now see letters coming out from the DWP that are 40 pages long. I defy anyone, even a graduate, to go through that and understand fully what they're being told. It's you know, this, the computers are generating information that is absolutely unnecessary, complex, and makes it very, very difficult for people to understand what the outcome of their claim is, whether they've got money or not. And usually the first thing they really know about is when they don't get the payment. You know, so this we do need to reduce the complexity in the system so that people can use it. And that would reduce costs. That would, because there'd be less reviews, less appeals, etc., because people would understand what they're being told by the Social Security system. You know.
So the aftermath, I was dealing with a case yesterday of a constituent who receives housing benefit, council tax benefit. She's in receipt of tax credits. And because of changes to her income, the system now deems her to have been overpaid. And I know others might think I'm stupid. I don't regard myself as stupid. I was a welfare rights officer for 14 years. And she came to me with the assessments, the results generated by the computer saying how much she has been overpaid in each of the periods. It is unbelievable. I couldn't understand it. And the irony is, when she went to the council to get an explanation, no one there could explain it either. So we're left with people that, frankly, are now helpless because of the complexity of the system, even when they can receive advocacy. Sorry, Neil, come back and then...
I'm the greatest supporter of advocacy services and you know, you mentioned West Lothian, a fantastic advice shop there and great work being done. But the fact that it's there and is rammed to the door, you know, 7 days a week or however many days it opens, is just indicative of the complexity and the problem that we're wrestling with. A couple of other things, I mean... had this been happening in isolation, then this would have been bad enough for disabled people. But it's happening at the same time as the frontline fight against poverty and inequality, which is local government. Don't care what MD says, local government's the frontline, is being absolutely having their heart ripped out it. So I think they're getting a double, treble, quadruple whammy in terms of what's happening to disabled people and all those support services that go in, all the small groups, the day centres, the, you know, the fruit and vegetable co-ops, all that kind of stuff that is the infrastructure, the scaffolding round about disabled people is being taken away as well. So, you know, I just think the combination of the two is catastrophic for a number of disabled people. And you mentioned, Bill, the disabled groups and carers will be competing with other groups for scarce resources. I think that's absolutely right. They will be. But when you look at how competition for scarce resources usually pans out, I'm pretty cynical about how successful disabled and carers will be when you compare it to, let's say, more middle-class areas, wealthier areas who will be competing for those resources as well. And I suppose my question to all of you is, do you think there's the political will is there with any of the political parties to prevent that happening?
I think we're going to face huge challenges because of the way that disabled people are being portrayed in the media and in political discourse as skivers, avoiding work rather than unable to work. And because of those attitudes in society, and they are much more widespread than they were a few years ago, every, you know, opinion poll that you look at says that there's a widespread belief that fraud levels are at astronomic level, you know, within the Social Security system. And with all of that, you know, with those beliefs in people's heads, it's politicians that have to appeal to that public to give them the support for what they're doing. So they've got a mountain to climb in overcoming the attitudes that have been created by programmes like Benefit Street, etc., the poverty porn that's on television. So I think you're going to face very difficult challenges. And I, like you, am cynical about, you know, our ability to compete for those scarce resources, because those with the loudest voices usually are at the front of the queue. And when that competition occurs, disabled people are stuck in their homes, unable to get out because they've not got their mobility anymore, they've not got the taxi card system, etc. They're not at the public meetings where local taxpayers are shouting the odds about they would rather have cuts to services rather than pay more. And so we need to be realistic about what we can do to begin changing those attitudes. And I honestly think, you know, promoting the idea of social participation, shouldn't everybody have the right to participate in society the same as everybody else, is one that will appeal within Scotland, because I think we do have an understanding of fairness and justice, and you know, that idea that we can help people to contribute in whatever way they're able to contribute. And that doesn't always mean work. It could mean being a volunteer down at the local community centre. It could mean going on a college course. I know, Neil, but what I'm saying is, if you begin to promote the idea that people should be able to do what everybody else does, mm-hmm. you know, takes for granted, then that might begin to change some of the attitudes that have been fostered over the last few years to justify benefit cuts.
John, and then Andrew and Nick.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to move the discussion on a little bit, just to talk about...
Convener, hold on, Kevin, chairman. If it's a different point, John, there's a couple of people that...
Well, it was just about the delivery of benefits, and it just sort of picks up a wee bit on Neil's point about whether... I mean, last week we had a good discussion about whether councils should be the principal body, or is that...
Can we just hold that then? And I think Andrew and Nick wanted to come in on the present issue. Okay, Andrew...
Yeah, I just wanted to come back to a couple of the points that Neil had made. And Neil, you talked about local authority funding and the difficulties there. And I think we need to keep in the context that lots of these... disability living allowance, lots of disabled people use disability living allowance to pay for social care. So it's non-residential social care is funded partly through that. And as a result, people coming off of that, the pressure is increased on social care. In terms of the point about advocacy, I don't know exact numbers of the number of people who need advocacy to go through the process. Some of the evidence that we're getting back from our project is suggesting that people wouldn't go to the assessment without an advocate there with them, so they wouldn't get the benefit at all. They wouldn't actually, you know, even go. So I think that's an issue that we need to consider. But I think we also need to think about, we talked about professionalisation, and it's professionalisation in a couple of different ways. So advice and information in advance of the assessment is different from advocacy during the assessment. So getting support to fill out the forms and all of that kind of thing is a separate thing from support during the assessment, giving the people the prompts during the assessment and supporting that way. I think what's becoming kind of clear from our project is that having someone knowledgeable about the assessment there with people is making a massive impact on the outcome, not just the outcome in terms of whether they get the benefit, but also the tone of the assessment, the kind of things that, the kind of treatment that people get, even just that knowledge of the person who is the advocate can say, well, you can take a break now. Because people might not know that you can take a break during that assessment. They might not know in advance that you can request a change in date once. You can't do it twice, but you can do it once. And one of the other things that we also need to consider is whether we need to make sure in future that there is GP and medical advice and social work advice in advance of those assessments happening so that reasonable adjustments can actually be made to the assessment process. We heard an example from one of our advocates earlier in the week of someone who has a range of multiple conditions, mental health problem, but they also have a learning disability. And in order to understand and articulate their own condition, it's quite difficult for them to do that in a face-to-face assessment. So they need support and prompting. They need the right kind of support about what this process is going to look like in advance and the knowledge of what it's going to look like, and then tailored advocacy support during it. I don't know how you create a system that kind of fends those issues off, to be honest.
I think I want to pick up another point that Neil made about the facing this sort of a perfect storm that's facing disabled people. The other thing that we're seeing is a huge cut in the number of people employed through the public sector. And disabled people, like most minority groups, are more likely to be employed in the public sector than they are in the private sector. And I think also to tie in with what Bill said, I mean, we did a bit of work a few years ago called Bad News for Disabled People, where we compared the way the media talked about disability in 2004 with 2011. There was a huge change in the way talking about skivers, lazy, good for nothings, people on benefits and so on. And actually, when you start to look at that, if you're a private sector employer and somebody comes to you and they've been on ESA for 2 years, and every time you've read in the press that they're lazy, feckless, good for nothings, and you've got somebody else to employ, you're not going to employ somebody who's been on ESA because you think that they're skiving. And I think, you know, Bill's point about higher levels of perception of skiving, we ran a series of focus groups, and we had, most people thought that fraud on disability living allowance ran at about 40%, up to 75%, yet, as Bill says, official figures are under 2%. And this is not coming from, because when people spoke about it, they all spoke about a relative or somebody they knew who had real trouble getting benefits, because they know that getting benefits is hard for their family, but somehow or other they think there are lots of other people who it's very easy to get benefits for because they're told about it in the media or it's on Benefit Street or some other program like that. And I think, you know, it's creating this real problem for disabled people to get the support and to be to receive the support that they need. It's not what, you know, people don't choose to go on to that lifestyle.
Okay. Joan, was it this issue or was it a different one for you?
It was about the benefits that are being devolved and reserved.
Can we come back to that then? Kevin, is it this particular issue?
I was going back to the question I already posed, which really folk didn't get the opportunity to answer, and that's about those folks who are currently in work, who if they lose their DLA, will probably then be unable to work. And about the costs, the lack of common sense in those reforms, and what that does in terms of the human cost to them. And I would like to hear if there has been any analysis done by folk around about those 16,000 people who, if they lose their benefits, are likely to lose their employment, which will set them back greatly, I would imagine.
Yeah, there has been some work done on that at a UK level, so I can probably do a breakdown of the figures and get back to you, Kevin, about what the likely costs are in terms of national insurance contributions and income tax, etc., in terms of those losses. I think that is possibly doable. On that particular issue, on the mobility component of DLA, there has been good work done on that. But, again, across the board, it's more difficult because, as we have to keep on saying, it's not just each individual cut, it's the cumulative impact on people. And certainly, again, there are fewer disabled people in employment now than there were at the beginning of the recession, even although employment rates for the general population have recovered to almost the same levels, although there's more part-time and self-employed work now in the system. But for disabled people, employment rates in Scotland fell from about 48% down to under 42%. And that's we've basically lost, you know, a part of the workforce that have been, as Nick has said, from the public sector and the third sector, where there were a lot of disabled people employed, there are fewer of them employed now.
Does anyone have specific figures that they could provide just now? No. Okay. John, and then John.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, my point was about the delivery of benefits moving forward in Scotland, and we had a useful discussion about this last week in terms of the role that local authorities and councils will play in that. I think there was a division of opinion in terms of whether people thought that was a good idea and whether they thought it was a bad idea, particularly with the possibility of introducing some sort of postcode lottery in terms of entitlement. And I just wondered if the panellists had a view on that.
Sorry, Rachel.
We've been talking about this issue in terms of the delivery of employment programmes, which are very much linked, obviously, with future benefit devolution as well, and about whether or not this should be taking place at a national level or through local authorities. And I think we would have some concerns about local authority delivery because of the postcode lottery and the inconsistent approach that some local authorities might take. We've seen this in practice it's a difficulty because you want to support localism, and we know that local authorities should know on the ground what's required from an employment point of view or what community support is required for people with disabilities. However, in practice, we have seen social care charges at different rates from the different local authorities and how that can impact on people's lives and on their finances. Self-directed support is another issue, and the delivery of the welfare fund have been applied in different ways. So we would be slightly concerned at the present time and with the imminent changes of health and social care integration about an immediate delivery of those benefits. Possibly in the longer term, it might be something to consider about more local delivery, but at the moment we are not convinced.
Sonia?
It's a really interesting question, because if you look at the devolution of public spending that's happening, say, in Manchester, then there is a real opportunity for better integration of health and social care and support that disabled people can receive, but we've yet to see that. So there is also what we've just heard in terms of postcode lottery. We know that there are varying differences in terms of health support that individuals get, access to social care assessments despite being severely disabled. We know that there are differences even within the current system of people waiting anything from 5 weeks to 8 months to get the outcome of an assessment. And when you think about the extra cost commission research that was done with people with neurological conditions, where their cost was an extra £200 per week, somebody waiting 8 months for the outcome of an assessment, that's an extra £6,400 that they're going to incur in terms of costs, as opposed to the £1,000 that somebody might incur waiting 5 weeks. So I think if we end up with a fairer, more equitable, more consistent service to people overall, or process overall, then fantastic. But at the moment, I would question where the evidence base is for that.
So can I just ask both Rachel and Sonia then? You have some concerns about localism, about the local delivery of services because of the inconsistencies. If we had a system that was predicated on national assessments but local service delivery, would that also cause problems, or are you talking about the same level of service delivery across the country, which would inevitably mean a national agency to deliver the services and taking the responsibility away from the local authorities? Which model would it be?
I mean, I think it's quite hard to answer that question, because in some senses I want to say you need a mix of both. You need local solutions for specific issues and difficulties, but you do need some consistency. Why should somebody living in one street get one form of service and greater support, and the person in the street next to them not be entitled to the same support, and yet they might have exactly the same disability, they might have a similar impact in terms of that illness. So there does need to be some consistency there. And, you know, there are savings by having a national approach. If you think about the back office costs and your overheads. But equally, if it's not delivered locally, then there are going to be, how would people, for example, with ME, if they had to travel, as they are now, 40, 50 miles to an assessment centre, which costs a huge amount of money, as well as having a major disabling impact in terms of their condition. You know, there's got to be a better approach to what we're delivering at the moment that is fairer, more equitable, but I haven't got all the answers.
I know what you mean. I see that locally in the contrast between those living, say, within the Rimshire Council area and Glasgow City Council, and it's just yards that separate them. But the issue of assessment for mobility in national centres is a different one from the assessment, once there is an assessment for entitlement, for the judgment and the decision about what level of service goes in, which is then down to the local authorities. Mm-hmm. So how do you eradicate that without removing that decision from the local authorities and setting up a national care agency?
I think it is a real problem about how we tackle it. And in a way, if different local authorities opt democratically to fund different priorities, then that could be seen as acceptable that this is what the local people choose to vote. But the real problem would be, of course, that we know that there are certain groups who will do better out of disabled children always do very well. When they get to 18, they do less well. So we know that. We know that people with a mental health problem will face stigma when it comes to accessing services or to local to people providing them with services. So, I mean, it's almost like you're trying to say you don't want to be democratic, but there is such stigma attached to some groups of disabled people that we can't go around saying that we will put this down. There has to be a decision. Sometimes it's taken about, and it feels that we are going to fund people with a mental health problem, and we're not going to put it out to say, should we be funding disabled children or should we be funding people with a mental health problem? Because if we went to a democratic vote, we know which one would win. But we've got to put it where someone has to make a decision where the need is greater and how you meet that need.
Okay, so what are we talking about? Are we talking about national decisions or local decisions?
I would national.
We specifically asked this question last year during the Smith Commission deliberations as to whether welfare benefits should be devolved to Scotland, and if they were devolved, who should administer them. And the overwhelming response was, yes, they should be devolved, and the Scottish Government should administer them, not local authorities. And again, we asked that question at AGM this year, and again, overwhelmingly, the response was that it should not be local authorities. And you may be suffering from disabled people's perception of the care system, and how unfair that can be. But people do not want to see that form of localism brought into benefits decisions. They want to see a consistent standard. And the evidence is, even from the Scottish Welfare Fund, that there are huge variations across Scotland in whether the money's even spent. And we know that poverty exists in every single corner of Scotland, and yet it's not being spent where it's needed to be spent on the people it needs to be spent on. So, that's with national guidelines in place. Disabled people are very, very suspicious of it being set down to local authorities and then not ring-fenced as well, that it gets spent on road repairs or whatever, rather than on disabled people's needs. So, unfortunately, if you were to take a straw poll with disabled people, I think you would find overwhelming opposition to local authority delivery. That doesn't mean to say you don't need local delivery of service. I think you do. I think that's part of the loss of humanity, is that it's a person at the end of the phone in Newcastle that you're having to deal with at the moment, rather than somebody that actually knows the local situation and what you face every day, that is the one that you're communicating your experience to. So that,
and a return to ring fencing?
No. I'm saying that is what disabled people's fear is, that the money would not be ring fenced.
No, but you're saying that it should be ring fenced.
Well, benefits expenditure at the moment is ring fenced in that sense. It's not spent on anything else. You don't set aside your social security budget and then say we're going to spend it on education or health. If you're saying that a disabled person in Glasgow could be told, well, you're not getting any whatever the new disability benefit is because we've decided to spend that on the roads, I think that would be decidedly unfair, because you'd be saying to disabled people, your human rights, we're going to ignore them because the taxpayers have told us there's other priorities. And I think that's going back to where we started for Andrew's point of view. That has to be based on human rights. And if there's a human right to participate in society, that isn't local. That is across Scotland. That is not whether you live in, you know, Inverness or Glasgow. You should have the same right to participate wherever you live. And that means that the benefit spend has to be ring-fenced.
OK, on this issue, bringing Christine and then I'm moving on to John.
To pick up on Bill's point and to pick up something Rachel said earlier about a more effective and more efficient service, and it ties into this argument about local versus national, and I don't think there is an argument there. I think, you know, there's room for a mix in that system. But how do we make it more effective and more efficient? One of the biggest fears of all of the people that I speak to and the roundtables that we've had and the Have Your Says and the constituents that come through my door is that they feel when they're assessed, the person assessing them has no understanding of what the impact of their disability has on their everyday ability to do what they need to do. And one of the biggest issues was the fact that a lot of them felt that their own GP's assessment or consultants were completely, you know, just ignored, completely and utterly ignored and not taken into account when that assessment was made. Would a more effective and efficient service be delivered at local level with taking into account all of the medical information that someone has got for their particular needs, assessed by an occupational therapist, for instance, you know, locally, to then make a decision on, you know, what somebody's eligibility would be and what level they require to function at that level, whether it's to stay in work or to, you know, do something, you know, worthwhile, that they feel works for them, rather than just being saying you've been put in that category, therefore you better go on to the system and you better get and find a job. Which seems to be, you know, just people are brushed aside like that now. So having that, you know, sort of a local information used to determine a personal profile, basically, for that person, and then delivering that effectively. And I think a transition cost of that would be, you know, quite substantial, but the actual impact of it would be that more effective and more efficient system. Maybe not. Opinion.
Capacity assessment used to take account of people's own doctors and GPs and consultants. The ESA, the work capacity assessment, actually stopped primarily because, I mean, I don't know, but you might say that it was because it was felt that people's own doctors might be too sympathetic to their own views. I can't comment on that, but it was so that it would take this idea of this dispassionate view that you didn't know who the person was and you would just come out with this alleged objective measure of what it was. But I think that, you know, going back to including and allowing your own GPs or your own consultants or evidence to take part would be a very welcome way of resolving some of the problems.
Do you think that system has what's created the inefficiency, in as much as a huge amount of these people go back on appeal and win the appeals because the original decision was the wrong decision?
It would be a much easier, you know, much more likely to be able to say, you know, this is, you know, genuine and well, I think this my patient has these reasons, and this is, there would be a much more longer term view. And if we're taking account of people with fluctuating conditions, for example, how somebody on a single assessment can tell that, whereas a GP or consultant will be able to take that into account. So it would be a much, make life much simpler and much more straightforward.
Okay. Sorry, Sonya, and then Bill.
I think
then you need a combination of both, because we talk to GPs who will say, well, I can assess somebody in terms of their health needs, but how that then translates into their actual workplace and whether they're able to go into work and function in work, I'm not equipped to assess that. So, you know, you could look at something like access to work, where you'll have an OT that will come and look at your workplace environment, will look at your specific needs, will take into account consultants' letters, GP letters, those kinds of things, and make recommendations. So, yes, there is a case to be made that if you have a system that takes on board and seeks the medical evidence and other evidence, and at the moment it's not. We've got examples in Scotland where somebody was asked to pay £100 for a GP letter and evidence, and you've got medical advisers and GPs who are refusing to provide letters because they can't cope with the demand and they're being faced with stretched services and cuts themselves. So if you have a system that looks at the individual, that looks at their specific condition and how it affects them in their specific circumstances, then you are going to get to a better place, I think. And, you know, going back to my example earlier, if you are paying for somebody to go repeatedly through a process when really they shouldn't be, let alone the human cost, and there is a massive human cost, but the financial cost cannot be justified. And I really do think there is a call for some actual economic evidence that looks at that in detail, because we're talking about should there be extra money or should it be localised or should it be held at a national level. What you want is something that's going to create savings so that those people that need a service and need support and need benefits will have that support and that funding available to them, because you've freed it up and you've not wasted that funding.
Just before I bring Bill in, could I just stick with a point you raised there about someone being charged £100 and others being refused? Should there be a recommendation that, as part of any system, that there's a change to GP contracts to require them to provide those letters of support?
I think if people are able to provide medical evidence, then the system should support them to enable them to get that. I think what we have to understand is that GPs are under considerable pressure, and so they have to have time to be able to provide that evidence and to be able to see their patient, and it has to be fair in terms of the amount of money that they get recompensed for that, because it will have a knock-on effect elsewhere.
Just one of these bureaucratic things that has to be dealt with separately. You don't deal with that as part of the benefit system. You'll have to deal with that as part of negotiations with GPs. But if we are looking at redesign, then perhaps maybe that's something we should recommend to make sure that everyone has access to that without charge.
Absolutely. And it goes back, your whole point is about integration. There's a lot of evidence for the benefit of integration. So given that there's a real opportunity here in Scotland to look at and do things differently, then integration should be the heart of it, as should participation.
Bill and then Andrew.
I think I made the case earlier on that, you know, the disability living allowance assessment regime was very, very different. It was largely based on a paper assessment, and it was largely based on a self-assessment of how the person's illness or impairment impacted on their daily lives. The difference with the personal independence payment is it identifies certain tasks and asks, are you able to do that without assistance or not? And it's essentially a functional test about those tasks, and you only score points if you cannot do those things unassisted. Yet with disability living allowance, there was much, much greater scope to actually say, how does this impact on my daily life? So there was a story being told, and somebody looking at that could say, that's a high level impairment, or that's a medium level impairment, or that's a low level impairment, and it's going to have different impacts on their lives. And I would like to see that, but I think also there is scope, much, much greater scope, for an integrated system where information is shared, because people are undergoing care assessments by occupational therapists. Are those care assessments shared with the benefit system? No, they're not. So you've already got an assessment that probably says this person is not fit for work. You know, will unlikely ever to be fit for work. And these are the barriers they face even in their home, which we are going to recommend how they can overcome those barriers. So there's a lot of information in the system at GPs, consultants, health visitors, etc. level that could be shared with any new benefit system that was set up, and again reduce costs. by reducing reviews, by reducing the number of appeals, because people wouldn't need to go to that, because the person making the initial decision would have much more evidence to base it on, and much more likely to make a decision that's closer to being correct.
I was just going to make a very similar point to that, just to say that there's lots of disabled people, people with long-term conditions, go through the health and social care system and experience lots of disjointed discussions and kind of this assessment process is all over the place, where, you know, Bill talked about lots of those different assessments that people are going through, and we need to consider this in the wider debate that's going on in terms of health and social care, about data sharing between professionals. Because I think there's something to be added around about what welfare, where welfare comes into that, and I think we need to come up with a solution which is about building the most accurate possible picture of someone's life whilst reducing the number of assessments and how many times they're asked that question. But what I would say is that there are polarised opinions about data sharing, so I'm not sure what the answer is there.
Rachel.
I think GPs are so often the gatekeepers, and we see welfare through a very employment focus and through the job centre, and we actually need to start thinking about health and welfare and employment in a much more integrated way. We are working with the Alliance and GPs at the deep end at the moment in terms of pilots at GP surgeries, where people who are unwell and presenting with a low-level mental health problem can be triaged and given support and community-based social prescribing support. And a lot of the reasons that people are actually presenting are work-related, and if people can be can access support upstream before they become very unwell, it's something that could actually prevent them falling out of work in the first place or requiring extra help and more intensive social care support in the longer term. I think we do need to think about things in the round and the person in the round and how their life could be affected and promoted through a much more preventative system.
Okay, right, I'll move on. John, thanks for your patience.
Thanks very much. Yeah, I think that it's important to bear in mind that, you know, we're looking at the future of social security delivery, and in Westminster Parliament, the Scotland Bill that will decide how that is. What powers we're going to have is still going through the Westminster Parliament, so we can live in hope of changing it. And I was struck by the evidence by Inclusion Scotland, where they were saying that they were disappointed that the Smith Commission proposals failed to address the key concerns and aspirations of disabled people, particularly in relation to powers of welfare and taxation and the national minimum wage. Is that still your position? It is, right.
We've consulted again since the Smith Commission, and we get back the same response, that they would much prefer to see all of welfare spending devolved to Scotland, apart from pensions. There's slightly less support for pensions coming here. But because of the complexities of the system and the way that benefits interact with one another, that it causes problems when you divorce means-tested benefits from disability benefits, etc. Sure. Yeah.
If I could just tease that out a wee bit, because obviously the big benefit that disabled people rely on, employment support allowance, is going to remain as part of the Westminster system, and it's going to be part of universal credit. And understand that there'll be a work preparation group as part of that ESA, which relates to the existing WREG group. Now, Ian Duncan-Smith has said that there's going to be more pressure put on that particular group to find work. And that means more conditionality and, I assume, more sanctions, which are also reserved to Westminster. What is your response to that? What kind of problems could that create for disabled people?
I think Rachel and I will be in total agreement on this, that particularly for people with mental health issues, behavioural problems, learning difficulties, these are the people that are being sanctioned on ESA at the moment. 60% of all sanctions fall in that group. And that is, you know, again, because of perceptions of people, you know, who administer the system, that they're not really ill, they just pull themselves together, they could work, or you know, do certain things. And largely it's because people don't understand the system they're dealing with or can't cope with the system they're dealing with because it makes them more ill. And therefore, you know, it really is a horrific situation that we're going into, because up until now, we've recognised that some illnesses are long-term and affect people their whole lives, people with ME, MS, etc. And now we're going to pretend that people can get rid of those illnesses within a year. And they can't. But after that year's up, they will go down to the same rate as an unemployed person, whereas unemployment benefit, as it used to be in Job Seekers Allowance as it is now, was always intended to be a short-term benefit that assisted people when they fell out of work, but with the expectation that they would go back into work. Whereas sickness benefit and incapacity benefit, you know, invalidity benefit, its predecessors from Employment Support Allowance, they were always intended to be long-term benefits for people who were unable to work. And to say to somebody in their 50s with a chronic condition like asbestosis that it's fine, we'll give you the support to return to work when, you know, they could be dead in 2 or 3 years. It's just completely unrealistic. And, you know, we as a society really need to look at ourselves and say, is that what we are condemning people to, is poverty when they become ill? Because that is what the outcome of cutting your ESA down by £20-30 a week will be for that group in the work preparation group. And as you say, all the sanctions, etc., are going to fall on that group as well. Completely unfair. We were talking earlier about people assessing you who had some understanding of the problem. A court has found that only people with experience treating people with mental health illnesses should really be doing those assessments for people with mental health conditions. Is that happening? No, it's not. The court's your decision is basically being ignored by the DWP. It is not happening in practice that every person with a mental health condition is being assessed by somebody who's got a speciality in mental health.
I said at the beginning, the evidence around RAG, the people being placed in work readiness assessment group, is that they're not being returned to work. Very, very few people are being returned to work, and it's actually failing as a policy. And most of the research is suggesting that people being placed in RAG are too far from the labour market to be ready to go for work. That they're being placed in RAG and it's failing them, and they're then going up. You know, the OECD published a big report in 2014 looking at the UK's activation policy. It was very, very critical of its use of RAG, saying that it wasn't working. And all that the government's response has been, well, we'll cut down the level of time people are getting into RAG, not looking at the categories of why is it that that people in RAG aren't finding work. And it's because the old PC, personal capacity assessment, would have discovered that people were too far from work to be placed in RAG, but that's not there. And I think that's one of the big problems we've got with ESA and at the moment, is it's the placing of people on RAG is that wrong groups of people are being put into the work. And possibly because too many people are being placed in RAG, it means that the resources that are available to provide employment support and to get people employed are too stretched. So rather than being able to concentrate on a smaller number of people who might be closer to work, it's actually having to spread out over far too many people, many of whom aren't close enough to the labour market yet. And I think that's a problem that we need to be addressing.
Okay, John, sorry, did you want to come back in there?
To reiterate those points, we know that the two employment programmes, the Work Choice programme, which is specifically for people with disabilities, is so much more effective because they have smaller caseloads, they have more specialised support, they have, you know, a caseworker for Work Choice is meeting with the disabled person once a fortnight at the minimum, whereas on Work Programme, where people on Employment and Support Allowance in the RAG group tend to be filtered through, it is a much less intensive support, and only about 5% or so of people with, rising to about 9% over time, for people with disabilities who are actually getting a job outcome after 2 years. We know that this is going to be devolved to Scotland, so obviously there's a chance for a bit more of a revolution within how it's delivered and hopefully a more humane approach. But we do hope that the cap that currently exists with work choice, because so many people, as Nick said, are put on the work programme rather than work choice, they'd actually benefit from a more specialised approach. And yet there's a huge number of people who have a disability in the employment market but just aren't actually getting that specialised support.
As well, to just the other issue, it's not just about supporting the worker who's going into work. Mm-hmm. The work from disabled people where they work, it's about supporting employers. Mm-hmm. About, because a lot of employers, I mean, it's the same that's used with, you know, bringing people from people who've been in criminal justice system, people who've been in care. It's about supporting. It's about, you've got to support employers, who, many of whom will not have employed disabled people before, and it's providing that support, and that's what works. And, you, and I think that the interesting thing about this local national debate, actually employment support is much better localised, because it is the local employments that are aware of the local employers and the local employment market. And we could look at that being more sort of localised in the delivery.
So, Rachel?
Point about the Scotland Bill going through and changes. One of the things that's missing from the Scotland Bill, which actually should be based on what the Smith Commission recommended in terms of employment programmes coming to Scotland, is that access to work isn't currently included, apologies, within the bill. And ourselves and inclusion, and I think most people around this table, I think in your in Action for ME's submission too, were supportive of access to work being devolved as well. In terms of being able to support employers to make whatever changes are necessary to workplaces to be able to facilitate people with disabilities being employed.
Then I'll come back to John.
One is, I would absolutely agree with Nick in terms of employment support. We've just set up a specialist pilot employment support project in the Bristol and surrounding areas, and that's integrated within the healthcare provision. And what we're seeing already is that that localised service has been able to meet the needs of some people with ME who are well enough to work or to consider working. That's different from the support they're getting from REMPLOY and from Job Centre Plus, etc. So I think that's really important to consider. I think the other point is that it comes back to your very original question, which was about principles. And we've got to remember that we're talking about disabled people. They're not a homogenous group. Some disabled people are much more badly affected by the stigma, the lack of understanding, the lack of awareness, the way in which society operates than others. And, you know, we've had some statistics around individual groups that are more badly affected, but, you know, we represent a group of people that are so badly stigmatised, and the ignorance and neglect that they experience is just compounded by the health system, by the social care system, and by the benefit system. So I think it's really important we don't slip into thinking about this as one group of individuals. Actually, it's a group of individuals where there are lots of subsets of conditions and illnesses and needs, etc.
Okay, Joan, and then Claire.
Yes, I guess what I'm getting at is the failure to devolve ESA. How is that going to affect our ability to deliver the system? We've spent a lot of time talking about how we're going to deliver benefits for disabled people, but the main benefit of disabled people is going to remain reserved. And can we realistically devise the kind of system we'd like to devise when that remains with Westminster?
Extremely difficult to devise a system that really is a wraparound, fully supportive system, because all of these benefits, as I say, interact with one another. You know, the rates that are paid through income support, as it is now, housing benefit, as will be universal credit, are affected by your entitlement to disability benefits, to carers benefits, etc. So if you want a fully functioning system that you can plan properly, you want the lot. However, having said that, we're getting what we're getting. We would like to see more still, access to work, for one. It's a very, very small amount of spending by the UK government at a Scottish level, six or £7 million a year. compared to what we are being devolved, very little, but it's not being devolved. And yet it's one of the key tools that can open up workplaces to disabled people, because it can support disabled people to get into work by providing adaptations for a new entrant to the workplace, but it can also support disabled people who are in employment, whose impairment becomes worse, or they have an acquired impairment, so that they can be supported to remain in the workplace rather than falling out of work. Because if they do fall out of work, the chances of getting back into work are extremely low. So you want that tool. And we've had meetings with Treasury officials where we've said, look, we're talking about a tiny amount of money. Why is it that the Treasury and the DWP seem so keen to hold on to this? Oh, it's administered by Job Centre Plus. No, it's not. It's administered by call centres in England. It's not administered by Job Centre Plus. And if we could get access to work, honestly, that is one of the smallest amounts of money that you can get, but one of the biggest potential for transforming Scottish society, because for small employers, the extra costs of taking on a disabled person can be the barrier. Let's face it. That somebody's facing £3,000, £4,000, £5,000 costs on top of the wage bill. No, it's not going to happen when they're comparing it against somebody that's going to cost them nothing. So you need that in place to overcome that financial penalty, particularly for small and medium-sized employers.
Thank you, Convener. I think Rachel and Bill have in some way answered to part of my question. But given that we're not getting everything that was even recommended in Smith, and the Joseph Rowntree Foundation said at that time that the proposals would land some way short of a great leap forward in poverty reduction or having any control of that inequality that we've talked about a bit today, I would just like to ask if there are any concerns about the vetoes that are written into the Scotland Bill, and whether you can see a position where perhaps Scotland would be ever able to introduce new benefits in this area, and just if there was any recommendations from those areas.
We're concerned about some of the inability to top up benefits within the Scotland Bill at present, especially if the individual has been sanctioned. We know that half of sanctions on ESA are overturned on appeal, so they're not being well applied, and they're having a massive impact at the time and in the weeks following the sanction itself until that money is processed and returned. And that's only if the individual is actually well enough to go through an appeals process and has the support that they often need to navigate and negotiate such a stressful procedure when they have already lost a lot of their income. In terms of one of the big impacts about inequality is going through alongside the Scotland Bill. The Welfare Reform and Work Bill is going through Parliament at the moment, and a lot of their changes will come into place from April 2016. So next April, people in JSA, Housing Benefit, Income Support, and the Employment Support Allowance Work-Related Activity Group, those benefits are going to be frozen for the next 4 years. And people who have been new applicants for ESA, and I don't know if that includes people who have just got to the end of their 12-month period and need to go through an assessment period again, will also lose about £30 a week, despite having the additional costs of their condition. So from an inequality point of view, that's going to have a massive impact, and we're very concerned about how that... I think that's going to a committee stage at the moment in the House of Commons, so it's a big challenge, because that will also then affect their ability to pay for social care services and be fully participating in society. So.
About the delays that the Secretary of State could impose on any positive changes that the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government wanted to bring about, because although they say that they won't unreasonably do anything, the universal credit system, as we can see, is having enormous teething difficulties, right? So making changes which will impact on that system, which doesn't work at the moment, the Secretary of State is going to be able to delay changes potentially indefinitely. that you might want to make which could have a positive impact on the lives of carers of disabled people, because they will impact on entitlement to universal credit, either the housing element or the former income support element could be affected by how you decide who is entitled to disability benefits or carers allowance. So, and again, on those benefits, we do not think that you're getting complete devolution of power. It's all shrouded round with all these conditions that the person must, if carer, they must not be in work, they must not be, in full-time education, they must not. That is not devolution. I'm sorry. that is not full devolution. And again, on sanctions, at the moment, the Scottish Welfare Fund can make a payment to somebody who has been sanctioned to relieve their poverty. Once the Scotland Bill is passed, they will not be able to do that because it precludes a payment solely on the basis of a person having been sanctioned. They'd have to have some other emergency that would justify the payment from the Scottish Welfare Fund. So the Scottish Parliament's ability to relieve poverty is not only not going to be increased in the area of the Scottish Welfare Fund, it's going to be reduced. So that's, again, in terms of delivering on Smith, I think that is completely at odds with what Smith said, where it said in the area of devolved benefits, you should have complete discretion.
Right, Christina, and then Neil.
Just a couple of quick points. I was wondering if I could get maybe a wee quick response from our panel this morning on the coroner's verdict from London this week, which found that the withdrawal of ESA resulted, and the actual verdict resulted in a man's suicide, and whether you've got a comment to say about that and where you go from there. But the other thing was about, I pick up on Joan's question about the sort of tensions between devolved benefits and reserved benefits and some of the issues within that. I see the Cabinet Secretary this morning, Alec Neil, has announced that the Scottish Government will abolish the 84-day rule for children with long-term conditions who find themselves in hospital for longer than 84 days. That 84-day rule is they lose their DLA and some other benefits if they're in hospital longer, and sometimes in a situation where their parents are under more stress and they've got more costs because they're visiting, they're taking shifts basically to sit in hospital. So my question is that the Scottish Government made that announcement this morning as soon as they've got control of DLA. Of the other benefits, attendance allowance, severe disablement allowance, carers allowance, is there any other aspects of those that you think immediately some things could be changed? And I know this is sort of a tinkering with the current system rather than developing a new system, but there is maybe things that we could do almost immediately that alleviate some of that problem. So the two issues there, the coroner's verdict and the whether there's any other scope within the devolution of further benefits to do something like abolishing the 84-day rule.
I was just going to say something about the first one of those rather than the second, and to say obviously we've talked a lot today about some of the impact of these assessments on people, and we've again through our project on advocacy we've seen lots of people who are very very nervous, experiencing panic attacks, things like that, and they feel that their mental health is being put at risk. Now what needs to be put in place is something after an assessment. In our view, there needs to be something in place after an assessment which has not resulted in someone receiving the benefit too. So if someone's been assessed as not being eligible, there needs to be some sort of process of signposting, of support somewhere. There needs to be some kind of, well, this is, you haven't received the benefit, but here's what is out there in the local community, for example. We have a links worker project which works in 7 GP practices in Glasgow, which is about supporting people to find community-based solutions to particular health issues that they might have. So something like that, in place across Scotland might be something which we could support or suggest.
Okay, anyone else? Sonia? Sorry, hold on a minute. Sonia.
I was just going to come back to the point you made about the coroner's report. Sadly, it's something that we do here, particularly with ME, but across the field in terms of the disability group. We sit on the Disability Benefits Consortium, and you look at the organisations there supporting disabled people, that actually it's a really sad thing that you hear on too many occasions. So I think there are some lessons in that need to be learned. I think there's also an interesting point that Andrew's just made in terms of how do you support people once they've had a no, and that hasn't been something that's been explored, certainly in the responses that I've read online and in talking with other organisations. So I think that would be something that you could consider sort of moving forwards.
Okay, Bill.
On the coroner's verdict, I think it's the tip of the iceberg, unfortunately. Black Triangle, one of the groups that we work with, has compiled a list. I think it's over 80 people who have committed suicide after an adverse benefit decision. Now, nobody...
80 people in Scotland?
No, throughout the UK. Right. But these are based on press reports of what the relatives said about the condition of their mind. Now, suicide is very complex. We never reduce it down to an adverse benefit decision. When a coroner makes that verdict, it's because that is what the balance of the evidence presented to them suggested was the reason. We don't have coroner's inquiries for every death, so that's why I'm saying I think it's the tip of the iceberg. What I can say is that I have had engagement events that we've organised on the phone, to the office. I have had people who are suicidal about the benefit decisions that they've faced, and going back to their dignity and respect, that's been robbed from them, and they've been reduced to feeling a less valuable human being than everybody else in society, and that is happening on a daily basis. I'm not hearing it all. We're not a frontline organisation in the sense that we provide advice and information to people who are doing it. This is people coming to us because of their wit's end, because they've nowhere else to turn, and they've met us before, at an engagement event. And it is incredibly difficult for us to cope with people who are suicidal on the other end of the phone. It has a real impact on our ability to function. Think about what it is for them, And I've heard people, who have really been reduced to nothing, by the system. And that's why we have to reform whatever we get so that it works for people. And going back to being centred on dignity and respect, one of the things we could do, again, with whatever system is devised, is ensure that everybody that's involved in administering it actually understands the group that they're working with, in the sense of they understand disability better. We would argue that everybody should undergo disability equality training, where people's discriminatory attitudes are actually challenged in that, and they're made to look at what the basis of their beliefs are and try and overcome them. Because without that challenge to existing beliefs, I don't think we'll get a proper change in the system.
Okay, Nick.
Obviously the coroner's report is one that I think it's the first time that we're officially recognising that this is happening, and I think that's I can't say it's welcome, because obviously, but it is something that we should be using to challenge the system, and I wouldn't disagree with anything Bill said. In terms of what we can do immediately, I think some of the key areas that we can look at is around providing support for people under ESA undergoing sanctions or people going for assessments. I mean, we've been looking at some areas. If you look at areas like POSL, where there's very high levels of people without any form of qualification, and with relatively low levels of relatively high levels of literacy, low levels of literacy, sorry. And a lot of those low levels of literacy, I think we might be looking at dyslexia as a result, but then being given benefit conditionality that involves filling in forms online means that you're not going to be able to complete it. And we know that middle-class children are much more likely to be diagnosed with dyslexia than people from areas of high social deprivation. I recently examined a PhD which virtually concluded that looking at dyslexia, that you know, middle-class children get diagnosed at age 8, working-class people get diagnosed in prison. And it's just that's putting it very crudely. But there is that real disparity, and I think that lots of people will be given benefit conditionality that they can't complete. They then get sanctioned. And it's not just the one-off sanctions of 28 days. They're bad enough. But when people are being sanctioned for up to 3 years, these are the real, which can be done without recourse to court of law. So we should be, one way to get around this is for us in Scotland to provide support and to actually start looking at why are people unable to fulfil their benefit conditionality? What is it that's happening? And if it is, if people are unable to fill in forms online, then we should be saying, you know, you cannot, under the Single Equality Act, you can't set people things to do, conditionality, that they can't compete because it's unfair on grounds of disability. And we could be looking at that. This might be one relatively straightforward way. I don't know, but it's something that we could look at. As why are people being sanctioned, and what can we do to keep the level of sanctions? If we can't stop the sanctioning, or we can't give people money if they've been sanctioned, then the thing to do is to stop the sanctioning in the first place, and to think upstream and see what is it we can do to prevent this to happen. And actually, in terms of, because the money isn't devolved, it might well become something that is a good preventative measure, and it might well be cost-effective in that local authorities won't have to meet it. Housing associations, sanctioning is affecting housing associations and their ability to meet their, because of people's inability to meet costs and so on. So I think it is a long-term preventative strategy. It would be a good thing to do.
Okay, thanks, Rachel.
The coroner's verdict about the individual who died by suicide, I would echo what Bill said in terms of the complexity around suicide and how difficult it is to attribute one reason. But we know from supporting the people, our service users, that we've had to make interventions to prevent suicide. We did a snapshot poll of our services a couple of years ago, and over the course of a month there have been 6 interventions. So we know that it is the stress and the financial anxiety and the fear of losing their support and fear of how that will affect their ability to pay for social care services too. All of these issues are really affecting people's mental health. I recall that the Mental Welfare Commission published a report, I think it was in the spring of 2014, about an individual who had died by suicide. And it was as they had attributed it as a result to them losing their benefits. And I don't know if it was through a sanction or I think it was through the ESA process. So, you know, there has been some evidence in Scotland of this happening. And I would echo Nick's point about trying to alleviate the challenges that people are facing following sanctions and how we can support them better. From an immediate point of view, we're going to see so many people by the time these benefits are devolved to Scotland who lose their DLA, who may also, their carers may lose their carers allowance if those individuals on lower rate care DLA are not going, their carers will no longer be able to claim carers allowance too. And how the carers bill in Scotland could deal with that as well.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else that hasn't contributed?
Sorry, I had begun to say earlier, carers allowance. You could address carers allowance. You should probably address, because carers allowance has fallen behind the other income replacement benefits like job seekers allowance and ESA. It's lower than both of them, and it's something that should be addressed, because if it's an income replacement benefit, then why are you penalising carers? And I think there is scope there, certainly, to address that. And, of course, carers live with disabled people, so it affects household income. So in supporting carers, you also support the disabled people in that house.
We've heard other comments as well, and it's not just about the level, it's also about how restrictive it is in terms of eligibility. Okay. Listen, thank you very much for a very illuminating and informative session. Sorry, Nick, did you...
Can I just make... and I would say this as somebody who's a does research, because we want the business. But I think if we do make changes, or when we do get the issues, we need to make sure that they're evaluated and that we're looking at what's happening. We don't just roll them out, which is what's happening in a lot of the, that you could argue that it's about making sure that the changes we make work. And so we have to make sure that we set up systems to evaluate what we're doing, and we don't just roll it out. I think that we've got the capacity here to make some changes to things like carers allowance and so on. And if we do make these changes, we need to make sure that they're evidenced and that we're doing them in a way that will make a difference and is making a difference to people's lives. I think that's it's really. As somebody who does research, obviously I'm going to try and promote it, but I do think we need to make sure that we're keeping an idea and keeping grasp of what we're doing and the changes are working in the right way.
Okay, thank you. Once again, thank you for your contribution. It's been invaluable to us. With that, we will move into private session.